The Journal of Gospel Music welcomes KCJ. Glad to have you here.
Thank you so much, Bob. I appreciate it. I'm happy to be here.
And I noticed that today that your single was number 14 on Billboard.
Oh, my goodness. That's so weird.
So it's just you and Lecrae and Tasha Cobbs and Kirk Franklin. You're just right on up there.
That's nuts.
Casey Janice Hobbs, was it at Lily Hill Baptist Church where you first started singing gospel?
It is, in Decatur, Georgia.
So tell us about that. How did that all come about?
Well, I was born into that church. That's the church that my family had been attending for years before I was born. And when I was born, my mom was actually the children's choir director. So as soon as I was big enough to carry the church, I was in the choir. And so I really started singing at probably about age two. And in fact, my mom's mom, my granny, was her choir director as well.
Wow.
So we kind of grew up in this tradition inside of the church. And so that's really where I just was able to just kind of express myself musically. I was definitely a church kid, so we were there at least 5 days a week. And out of all those 5 days, I was singing all five. So, and I'm thankful to have a family that really made church such a normal part of my development, a normal part of my childhood. I think about church even more than I think about the time I spent at school or anywhere else, just because we spent a lot of time there and I was able to really develop there. So I was able to really just kind of develop along with my mom.
Sounds like a real strong foundation spiritually and musically.
Absolutely.
So now tell us about the Atlanta Young Singers of Kellenwald. How did you end up being part of that group?
I joined Atlanta Young Singers, I believe I was in about seventh grade. And at that time, you know, if you have children, you know, we kind of go through phases. I want to be a dancer. I want to do karate. And so I had went through a couple of phases of things I wanted to do, but music and singing was definitely what I had the biggest passion for and what I really had the biggest gift for. And so when I just convinced my mom that I really wanted to do something there. And I was playing sports and doing some things athletically, but my mom found this organization, Atlanta Young Singers of Kellenwald, and we applied, and they were gracious enough to accept me into their music program. And funny enough, when I graduated from college, after I had been teaching for a couple of years, I actually went back and worked for them for about 2 years as their communications and marketing person. So I worked actually with the same people that I worked with when I was a little girl. I came back as an adult. I was able to work with young people for about 2 years there with them, and it was an amazing, amazing experience. They exposed me to so many different genres of music, so many different languages that music comes in. So we were seeing a lot of sacred music, so in Latin and in French and in Italian and all those different languages, and I was really able to just kind of broaden my perspective of music, and I'm thankful for that. So I know that music doesn't just belong in the church, but there are other places that we can really share that gift.
Along those lines, who have been some of your music influences?
My ultimate music influence as far as gospel music is definitely, and I wouldn't even want to put the word gospel on him, but it was definitely the Israel Hope.
Okay.
I just really, really admire that he always puts out accessible music. You can sing his song in a gospel church. You can sing his song in a contemporary Christian church. Like, his music just really skips over genres. It skips over, you know, age and skips over different denominations, and it really is able to be ministered in so many different arenas, and I really admire that, because that's an aspiration of what I really feel God has placed in my heart, to not necessarily be for one local church or one type of local church, but really called to minister with the church. And he definitely has grasped that concept and made it his own.
And do you remember when the first time you heard Israel?
Ooh. The first song I remember is I'm a Friend of God, but I'm sure I heard something before then. But that was the one that really stands out to me is he has a live recording of I'm a Friend of God. And when it wasn't just, and he was the first one that really got me into live worship, where you could hear the people at the concert, and he put that on an album. You could hear the people worshiping. You hear him, he has an awesome gift, and his fingers are amazing, but you could really hear the sound of worship in each of those environments.
And you bring up a good point. In fact, I was talking to Wanda Nero Butler about this very same thing, that it seems like, whether you want to call it gospel music, inspirational music, the live environment, whether live or recorded live, is the best because of the people.
It is. It absolutely is. I think one thing that the gospel music or inspirational music, as you refer to it, one thing that we have that no other genre has is we can literally change in my opinion, like, we can change the lives of people by what they're singing out of their mouth. They're affirming and confirming some things about themselves through singing.
That's
and
right.
So it doesn't have to be the most talented person. You can be a person at the concert in the back that's tone deaf, but God still hears and responds to our worship when we collectively meet together. So it is an awesome thing.
Well, now, have you ever fancied going on Sunday Best?
I am not competitive or like competition driven, not for music. Anything else, sport, any other like competition or something like that, I am absolutely ready for it. And you know, I and some of the people that are on there are phenomenal singers. I will leave that to them. I have never, and maybe I'll change my mind one day, but right now, I will definitely leave it to them. I will let them.
I hear.
Killing.
It's for them. Yeah, it's not for you. I understand that totally. Well, now, how did you meet Marcus Boone?
Marcus, I met him through, we have a mutual friend, Corey. And so when Marcus was starting his church, he brought on our friend Corey as the worship pastor. And so I was singing with Corey, and he asked me to come and just kind of help the church out and sing a little bit. And fast forward 5 years later, now I'm the worship pastor here, and I haven't left.
That's great. Now, I understand Fill Me Up. You did not write that song. It was composed by someone else. How did you come
Will Rankin.
How did that come about? How did you link up with that song?
Well, that song really, I heard it probably about, it was before our church, so probably about 6 years ago, we went and visited a church, and someone sang it. I was like, that song is amazing. And about 4 years later, when we were here at my church, Fresh Start Church, we were planning a worship conference. And God had really laid on our hearts to do a conference just for people who serve in worship. So musicians, singers, dancers, light technicians, media production, all of those things, to do a conference just for them. And the conference was entitled Refuel. And so what we had to think of, and what I and the worship pastor at the time were really considering, is what song really captures what we think God is trying to do through this conference. And so it was probably about 2 months before, and we said, okay, we're just going to start, you know, looking out there and seeing what songs are out there. Maybe we'll write something. Maybe we'll, and probably about a month before the conference, that song just came back to our memories, and we remembered Fill Me Up. And so the night of the conference, I released that song in worship, and we just sang it as a congregation, and people from all different churches, different cultures, different ethnicities, different church affiliations. Some people didn't go to church at all. They were just there for the night of worship. And we all just sang that song, and God really allowed me, and I didn't know it at the time, but over the next 2 years, he allowed me to really live out those lyrics of that song. And so when I felt, you know, that God had really given me a command to not just serve the local church, but to do something on a bigger perspective, that's the first thing that came to mind. And I was nervous. I was like, Will Reagan wrote for Jesus Culture. I mean, he wrote Break Every Chain. He wrote, like, those are all his songs. I'm like, he does not want some unknown girl to come and sing his music. And he was so gracious to allow me to minister, and has been so gracious. And even, you know, complimented the way that we interpreted the song and interpreted the ministry of that song. So it was definitely a God connection, because he didn't know me from, as my mama said, doesn't know me from Adam or Eve, and chose to allow me to minister that.
Well, you certainly did him proud, because this song is on the Billboard charts. Once again, he's got a song up there, so that he's got to be so happy.
If you provide the fire, provide the sacrifice. If you pour out your spirit, then I will open up inside. Fill me up, God.
Fill me up,
God.
If you pour out your spirit,
What does the mm-hmm. song mean to you? And you mentioned how you've had to live that out over the last couple of years.
Well, I'm a teacher, so that's what I went to school for. That's what I do now. And probably about about 3 years ago, I was in my classroom, and I had been praying that, you know, God give me some clarity about what purpose He really has for me. I love teaching. I still love teaching. It's definitely a passion of mine. But I felt like God wanted me to do more. And so He had kind of given me that word, like, you know, I'm going to do more for you. And about 6 months after I heard Him get that word, I had become frustrated. And I know, you know, most people won't say, you know, I was frustrated to the point I was almost angry or upset with God. And I remember sitting in my classroom and I said, you know what, God, you said you were going to do something great. You said you were going to do something different. And it's been 6 months and you haven't done it yet. And I'm being obedient. I'm serving. I'm showing up at the school an hour early and then leaving an hour late and then driving an hour and a half to your church to serve your people. It was real. A lot of attitude, a lot of anger. And I said, well, why haven't you done it? Why haven't you done what you said you were going to do? And then in that classroom, as clear as day, He told me, you're asking me for something that you haven't made room for me to do. So He kind of corrected me and said, you know, I want to do this for you, but you haven't taken the steps of faith to really allow me to facilitate or to prove that you really can handle what it is I want to do in your life. So I made a decision that day that I gave Him a yes, and I said, God, whatever you want to do, I'll do it. And the next day He said, well, don't sign your contract.
Uh-huh.
If you're a teacher, you know that's like, wait, what?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, God, I'll do what you want me to do. Just don't mess with my money, please. So I have a car, I have a house. I didn't sign my contract. And that whole summer,
wow.
I was just kind of putting in applications in places, and I didn't really know what I was even looking for. And the summer went by. So now school's about to start. And I haven't had a job. Thankfully, I got paid through the summer from school because I was, that's kind of how our payment was working out. But I didn't have a job. I didn't have anything. And it was the end of July. And the week before school started, I got a call from a school. And I was telling God, I mean, God, I don't want to go and work in another classroom. I'm going to be just as limited as I was the first time. And the school was an online charter school. So I was able to work from home. I had a flexible schedule. And then after that, God just really began to open doors for me. I was able to come on here at Fresh Start Church as the worship pastor at the top of this year, when I was able to really fill me up in March, and God has just been really doing everything just off of that one yes. And I had a yes. I was ill-prepared. But when I gave Him the yes, He really made everything up so clear for me. And so now I'm just walking in that same attitude. Wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, whoever you want me to love, whatever you want me to sing, and it's working out. So I'm going to stick with that plan. Go ahead and throw my plans away.
That's cool. And that... What is next for you? An album, a tour? What will you be doing?
I'm doing some national things. I visit a few places and make a few connections. But the goal is that at the top of the year, you'll release a project for you'll hear. Fill Me Up, of course, from Lil Reagan, but I actually write, so you'll hear some things that I've written that will be on there as well. So that's what we're doing right now. But you know me, you don't know me, but if you do know me, I'm all about timing. God was so perfect in His timing for everything, and I want to make sure that whatever I do it inside of His timing, because the right thing at the wrong time can be wrong. So I'm just kind of saying, God, okay, what do you want for this chorus? What do you want for this verse? How do you want this to sound?
Well, would you like to make gospel music a full-time career?
I would like to make ministry a full-time career, and whatever avenue kind of facilitates that, I'm absolutely down for. I love being a worship pastor. I love that it's equally, it's one thing to minister to people who you see and you go to a concert and you sing and then you leave and you get back on the plane and you go back. But there's nothing like worshiping at home. So I always want to have a home where I minister. So any facet of ministry I'm open to, absolutely.
And you are now located in what city?
I live in Atlanta, and our church is in a suburb of Atlanta called Duluth, Georgia.
Duluth, Georgia. Okay. But you definitely have to tell us before we go your response when you found out that the single had really hit.
Okay. I haven't grasped that thought quite yet. Look, I know it. And like when you said 14, I was like, what? Why did you even look at that up? It still like really is very strange to me. But, and I think what I love about it and what I love about kind of this process that God has taken me on, I don't really see it as me being on the Billboard chart. Mm-hmm. I see it as Him being on the Billboard chart. So He's becoming more famous. And I'm just kind of the person who's facilitating that. I'm, I'm just like the person on the tarmac that's kind of guiding the plane in, like, look this way. And I get to really put a spotlight on what he's done in my life and what he can do in others' life. So I keep kind of that same perspective. Like, you're just the same person. You know, God is using you in a special way, but he's really the star. And so when I hear that, you know, you're number 14 on the Billboard, I'm like, oh my gosh, he's number 14 on the Billboard. He's number one on the Billboard. And I definitely get a lot more joy in that thought than the thought of me having some type of personal success. Because I know I didn't work my way here. I'm not here because I was so perfect all the time. You know, I just served and sowed and trusted my way to this place. So I'm just going to keep doing that.
Well, it's a good attitude to have. And people who want to pick up your single, where can they go?
The easiest place to find me is on www.kcjmusic.com. That's kcjmusic.com. And you can purchase my music anywhere you purchase your digital music. So iTunes, Google Play, Amazon. I'm also on YouTube, Instagram, and you can find me on that website and kind of connect, and I get to meet new people from everywhere, which is really cool.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, KCJ, thank you for spending time with the Journal of Gospel Music. Congratulations on the single and your career.
Oh, thank you so much.
And we look forward to hearing more about you and your ministry in the months and years to come.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.